Today's presentation, I'm going to be talking about a brief background about transcranial magnetic stimulation. After that, subsequently, we'll be talking about a fairly new field, which is the use of TMS in various addictive disorders. So yeah, this would be the learning objectives for the presentation. We'll start off by talking a little bit about the principles and the various terminologies that are used in transcranial magnetic stimulation. Then we'll be talking to you about the types of stimulation and the various coils, so basically the paraphernalia that are associated with the use. Then about how to administer TMS. Subsequently, we'll be talking about side effects and safety concerns. Then finally, I'll be talking about indications. These are basically the recognized indications of TMS, both in neurological and psychiatric illnesses. And finally, a brief note on TMS in addiction. Okay. So just as a brief background, transcranial magnetic stimulation has its origins that date back as far as to Michael Faraday in 1831, when he gave the principle of electromagnetic induction. Now, once these laws of electromagnetic induction were given, following that, there have been many attempts that people have used to actually use magnetic stimulation to stimulate both nerves and brain tissue. Most of these early attempts were unsuccessful. And it was not until 1985 when Professor Anthony Barker and his colleagues at the University of Sheffield were actually able to succeed in stimulating brain tissue using transcranial magnetic stimulation. Now, while most of us associate transcranial magnetic stimulation with magnets, it is actually a bit of a misnomer, because when it actually comes down to the action on the brain parenchyma or on the brain tissue itself, it actually activates electrical currents in the brain tissue. So in the end, the final end product is an electrical stimulation, but the medium for doing that is through a magnetic stimulation. I will be explaining a little bit more about that subsequently. So when we're talking about brain stimulation methods, there are various brain stimulation methods, some of which will be talked about later in this module as well. So these include things like transcranial direct current stimulation, then transcranial alternative current or electrical current stimulation. Then there is TMS or transcranial magnetic stimulation. And of course, there are the older brain stimulation modalities, that is ECT and deep brain stimulation. Now, of these, TMS, TDCS, they are what are considered to be non-invasive brain stimulation modalities. But obviously, they are considered to be slightly more focal. And the depth of penetration from the skin surface to the brain tissue varies between TDCS and TMS, depending on the mode of application. So as far as TMS is concerned, between 20 to 40 millimeters or 2 to 4 centimeters is the depth of penetration of the transcranial magnetic stimulation waves under the skin's surface. So obviously deep brain stimulation, where an electrode is placed in the brain, has the maximum potential for penetration. So what one needs to understand is that the reach of TMS in that sense, it is mostly with superficial brain structures. So as far as stimulation of deeper brain structures are concerned, it is not as effective. So as I was mentioning, the principle behind the TMS, so there is a conducting coil through which current passes. So essentially there is an electrical current which passes through a conducting coil, and this generates a magnetic field. So that is what is electromagnetic induction. And what we do is that a brief magnetic field is generated, which is perpendicular to the plane of the coil. And this magnetic field passes through the skin and the subcutaneous tissue, and it generates an electrical current in the brain. So these superficial electrical currents are called eddy currents, and the final aim is to cause depolarization of the underlying neuron. So basically it causes firing of neurons under where the stimulation takes place. So as a consequence of this, there are both acute effects as well as prolonged effects that are noticed from TMS. So now, obviously, the acute effects, since there is depolarization of the underlying neurons, there would be phasic activations of particular neural circuits depending on where the TMS coil is placed. So if the coil is placed over the motor area, there will be observable motor responses like twitches. Depending on, say, if the coil is placed over the Broca's area, there can be temporary disruption. For example, there might be speech arrest, or else, again, if it is placed over, say, the DLPFC, there might be facilitation of ongoing processing, like increasing speeds of reaction time and so on. Now, apart from the acute effects, which will be there if you administer TMS immediately, and that's obviously because of depolarization, the interest that is there, at least as far as neurological and psychiatric disorders, is its effect on neuroplasticity. So TMS is supposed to be influencing neuroplasticity in the long run, and it does this by changes in synaptic efficiency. Predominantly, it is supposed to be working at the glutamate synapse, and it has features or actions akin to what are called long-term potentiation or depression. So essentially, these are characteristics of the glutamatergic synapse, where the plastic changes that take place in the brain outlast the immediate receptor activation or the synaptic activation. Apart from that, there is also alterations in neurotrophic factors, and the prolonged effects of TMS also impact cortical excitability and connectivity amongst various functional brain circuits. Now, before moving on to the nitty-gritties of the TMS, there are a few terms that one needs to understand which would come up again and again. One is, of course, what is a pulse? So a single magnetic stimulation event is called a pulse. A burst is a combination of three pulses, which is given at a frequency of 50 hertz. And then one comes to something called a train. So a train is either a series of pulses or bursts, which are given together in a fixed pattern, and they are used repetitively. So when we're going to come down to different types of TMS, these terms would get used again. And essentially, the dosing of the TMS, or the way in which the TMS is given, basically varies based on the number of trains or the interval between the trains, as I will be explaining subsequently. So when one talks about types of TMS, there is single pulse TMS, paired pulse TMS, and repetitive TMS. So the terms are fairly self-explanatory. So single pulse means there is a single pulse, paired pulse two, and repetitive TMS is, again, there are multiple pulses that are there. And amongst repetitive TMS, there are two types. One is what is called conventional TMS, and the other is something that is called patterned TMS. Now, it is of interest to note that TMS has got uses both in terms of investigating or rather diagnosis, as well as therapeutic uses. So TMS has been used as an investigational tool for understanding neurophysiology, understanding how nerve cells depolarize. And so single pulse TMS and paired pulse TMS are generally utilized for diagnostic purposes, barring a few exceptions. Repetitive TMS is by and large used for therapeutic purposes, and since the focus of this presentation is going to be therapeutics, we are going to be talking mainly about repetitive TMS in the upcoming slides. So as I had mentioned, there are two types of repetitive TMS. One which a lot of people are familiar which is called the conventional RTMS. So here, basically, there are two subtypes, mainly low frequency RTMS and high frequency RTMS. I will be showing you a diagram to illustrate this. So essentially, in low frequency, the frequency of the pulses or the stimulus rates are less than 1 hertz. And that is seen to be inhibitory to the underlying cortex. So basically, it would depress the action of the cortex underlying the coil. High frequency RTMS, they have stimulus rates greater than 1 hertz. Generally, the stimulus rates are 5 hertz, 10 hertz, and 20 hertz. And they are generally seen to be facilitatory to the underlying cortex. Now, again, this is not a hard and fast rule, but for our purposes and for the purpose of understanding, this would be the easiest way to understand it. Now, apart from this, there are what are called patterned RTMS. The most common patterned RTMS is something called theta burst stimulation. So as I had mentioned, a burst is three pulses which is given at 50 hertz. And a theta burst is three pulses which is given at 50 hertz every 200 milliseconds. So essentially, that would mean that there are 10 bursts that would be there every 2 seconds. Now, a train in theta burst stimulation comprises of 10 such bursts. Now, as I had mentioned, amongst theta burst stimulation, similar to low frequency and high frequency RTMS, there is something called continuous theta burst stimulation or CTBS and intermittent theta burst stimulation or ITBS. So CTBS, as the name suggests, there is no off phase. So basically it is a continuous, there are continuous drains that take place, and it is noted to be generally inhibitory to the underlying cortex. So the ITBS, there is a 2 second phase where there is the theta burst or the train of theta burst which is delivered, and then there is 8 seconds where there is no stimulation which is delivered. And this kind of stimulation is seen to be facilitatory to the underlying cortex. So yeah, this is a picture to illustrate this. So essentially on the left side, you see the conventional RTMS. So essentially in 1 second, the one on the top left of the screen, so here. Yeah, no, okay, I'm not able to indicate it, but the top left, the first, this thing in the conventional RTMS, it's 1 hertz. So that is every second, there is one pulse that is there. Similarly, in 5 hertz, there are 5 pulses in 1 second. 10 hertz, there are 10 pulses in 1 second. And 20 hertz, similarly, there are 20 pulses in 1 second that are noted to be present. In the patterned RTMS, as you can see, there are 3 pulses which are there in 200 milliseconds. And so within 1 second, there are a total of 10 pulses that are there. So that is 30 total pulses which would be there. So similarly, in ITBS, which is the second diagram, there is a 2 second train followed by 8 seconds of no stimulation. In IMTBS, which is something called intermittent theta burst stimulation, there is a 5 second continuous stimulation followed by 10 seconds of no stimulation. So essentially, these are different patterns which are used, and they are being investigated in various disorders. The patterned RTMS is what is being used increasingly, since it is seen to have longer effects on neuroplasticity compared to conventional RTMS. Now, apart from the pattern by which the RTMS is actually delivered, the other important consideration is the type of the coil which is used. Now, initially or historically, what was used was something called a circular coil, and the stimulation that was delivered was greatest around the circle's edge, but it was low in the center. So as a result of that, the focal nature of the stimulation becomes less, and it is a more diffuse stimulation that takes place. So to correct the problems with the circular coil, a figure of eight coil was something that was developed, and that is what is most commonly used in most RTMS deliveries. Here, the highest intensity will be at the juncture of two circles. I will show you some images of these. Apart from that, for stimulating deeper brain structures, there are different types of coils. One is, of course, something called the H coil. And apart from that, there is something that is called the double cone coil, which is used. So the one on the left of the screen, as you can see, is a circular coil. Then right to the right of that, there are two circles. And as you can see, there is a dot where the two circles intersect. That is the point of maximum stimulation, and that is called a figure of eight coil. And the two coils on the bottom are the double cone and the H-shaped coil, which are used to stimulate deeper structures, so up to 4 centimeters from the skin surface. So obviously, the superficial coils have the advantage of more focality, so they are more focal. The deeper coils or the H-shaped coils, they have more power, but their focus is less. So it is more diffuse, more structures get innervated as a result of that. So now when we're talking about how to administer TMS, there are certain considerations that are there for administration. So the first and most important consideration is scalp position. And this is determined by two methods. So the classical method is actually something that borrows from electrophysiology or EEG physiology, wherein there is something called the 10-20 system, which is used to determine where electrodes are placed in EEG. So the 10-20 system, as you can see, you need to take, so I'll basically explain to you briefly how the 10-20 system works. You take a measuring tape and then you measure the distance from the nasion to the inion. So nasion is the front part of the in the front part of the head, where the root of the nose meets the forehead, and the imion is the protuberance of the highest point on the external occipital protuberance. So you take a measuring tape, measure the distance between the nasion and the imion, and the center of that is marked out. So that is one point, and the other point is the distance between the two auricles, or the interauricular distance, which is measured. And again, the midpoint of the interauricular distance is marked out. And so this point, where there is the intersection of these two points, is what is called the vertex, and that is marked as CZ. Okay. And then there are intercepts that are there. So 10%, 20%, and 20%, as you can see in the figure. And this is generally how the localization of various brain regions has been done historically. Now, in the modern era, this thing has been made a little bit more sophisticated, and they have used something called neuronavigation. So neuronavigation is essentially something where you use something called a stereotactic frame, which is placed on the person's head, and a structural brain imaging is done. And subsequently, this is superimposed upon the stereotactic frame. So there will be surface representations of various parts of the brain that can be made out using this. So there are specific softwares which are used to actually do this. I do not have much knowledge about neuronavigation, because as part of my thesis, I'm using the old conventional method of actually determining where the electrode, where the coil has to be placed. So So apart from the fact that you need to determine where the coil has to be placed on the scalp, the other determinations are, of course, the coil shape, like I mentioned, as well as the orientation of the coil. So generally what is practiced is that the coil is placed at a 45 degree angle to the sagittal plane. So that is when there is maximum stimulation of the underlying brain parenchyma. So for example, if you place it parallel to the sagittal plane or perpendicular to the sagittal plane, the type of stimulation that may occur will be slightly different. So it is very, very important, and you have to be mindful about the way that you orient the coil as well. The other consideration for administration is whether it is single pulse or repetitive pulse. So generally for our cases, we use repetitive transcranial magnetic stimulation. Now, apart from this, so like say, for example, you have doses of medications, right? So similarly, you have doses of RTMS as well. And so the doses of RTMS are determined by all of these factors. One is, of course, the train frequency, duration, the total intensity and total pulses which are there in one session. In addition to this, one needs to determine the inter-train interval. The other thing is the number of trains per session. Then there are the number of sessions per the day, and the number of days in a course. So all of these factors can vary, and they can influence the dose of RTMS that can be that is given. So by varying each of these parameters, you can actually get a slightly different outcome from what will be there with a different parameter. So now, of course, whenever you're talking about a new modality as far as treatment is concerned, I think one concern that both doctors as well as clients and patients have is about side effects. So everyone asks, what are the side effects? So generally, RTMS is seen to be a very safe and well-tolerated modality. Obviously, the biggest worry or the biggest concern, since you are stimulating the brain tissue underneath, and you're in a sense, you are creating an electrical stimulation focus, is the fact that it has a risk for inducing seizures. Now, the risk for induction of seizures is generally quite low with RTMS. In fact, there are actually counted number of reports of seizures. So over a period of the last 25 to 30 years that RTMS has been used, there have actually been only about 10 to 15 episodes of seizures that have been noted to be present. But the prevalence is cited as anywhere between 1 to 2 in 1,000 for seizure induction. If you look through the literature, what they've said is that a lot of these patients who actually had seizures had a possible risk of having seizures either because of the medications that they were on or the conditions that they had even before the seizure actually occurred. So it needs to be taken with a bit of a pinch of salt. So apart from this, the other side effects which are very common are a transient headache or local pain, neck pain, toothaches, and paresthesias where the site of stimulation is there. Apart from this, there can be transient hearing changes. So patients can report some amount of hearing alteration, which is fairly transient. Generally, what we recommend is we actually give cotton plugs or ear plugs when the TMS is being administered. And apart from that, there can be a risk of transient induction of hypomania in some patients, as well as transient cognitive or neuropsychological changes. And very, very rarely, this is hardly recognized, burns from scalp electrodes. That being said, as I said, again, because it is a new modality and we need to be very, very careful as to the safety and the ethical considerations, there is actually something which is called the Transcranial Adult Safety Screen, or the TAS, which is used in most RTMS studies. And that includes questions like, have you ever had adverse reactions? Have you ever had a seizure? EEG? Have you had stroke, neurosurgery, any metal inside the head, any implanted devices like cardiac pacemakers, medical pumps, frequent headaches, any other brain-related conditions or injuries, whether they are on any other medications for neurological conditions. Again, if you're women of childbearing age, if there's a family history of epilepsy, and any further explanation regarding TMS and its associated risks. So essentially, if any of these items are scored yes, then generally one needs to be cautious and warn the patient when actually giving TMS. So this is a set of 14 questions. It's freely available online for anybody who's going to be interested in using TMS. So now briefly, I will be talking to you about the indications, and these are the standard and accepted indications both in neurology and psychiatry. So as far as indications in neurology are concerned, the indications include neuropathic pain, where there is definite analgesic effect of high frequency RTMS to the M1 or the motor cortex contralateral to the side of the pain. In Parkinson's disease, there is a possible anti-Parkinsonian effect of TMS to the bilateral motor cortical regions. Again, there has been effects noted in both motor stroke as well as tinnitus. Now, as far as psychiatry is concerned, that is where actually the major indication for RTMS has been noted, and that is actually in depression, where there has been a lot of literature, including some trials. So basically, there were some double-blind RCTs which were done around 2007 and 2008 in the US and Australia, which showed very positive results of RTMS, high-frequency RTMS to the left dorsolateral prefrontal cortex in alleviating depression. And subsequently, after that, it has gotten an FDA approval for treatment of depression, which is actually the only indication for which RTMS has FDA approval. So what has been noted is that there is definite antidepressant effect of high frequency RTMS to the left dorsolateral prefrontal cortex, and that this effect is generally seen in unipolar depression, but there is no recommendation for bipolar depression. There is also some probable antidepressant effect of low frequency RTMS to the right DLPFC that is noted to be present. But no differential antidepressant effect between the right-sided low-frequency RTMS and the left-sided high-frequency RTMS. Now, this is something that is frequently seen in RTMS studies, that actually inverse stimulation of the hemispheres is seen to actually have distant actions on the contralateral dorsolateral prefrontal cortex as well. So, in addition to this, there have been trials of RTMS with possible effect of low frequency TMS at the left temporoparietal cortex for treatment resistant auditory hallucinations, and some probable effect of high frequency RTMS to the dorsolateral prefrontal cortex in negative symptoms of schizophrenia. There has been a lot of work that has been done in psychiatry in anxiety disorders, OCD, PTSD. But unfortunately, at this current stage, there haven't been any positive recommendations that have come out of this. But still, there is a lot of work that is being done with different kinds of stimulation parameters. So finally, I will talk to you a little bit about, as I said, this nascent field of RTMS and addiction. So briefly, I will tell you, so as I said, there are different areas, as you would be aware, which are implicated in the neurocircuitry of addiction. So the common areas which I talked about are, of course, the dorsolateral prefrontal cortex, which is associated with cognitive control, the OFC, the anterior cingulate cortex, which is associated with error monitoring, the ventral striatum, which is, of course, in the midbrain, which is in the subcortical regions. There is the amygdala and the ventral tegmental area. In addition to this, of course, the insula is another area which is supposed to be implicated in addiction. Now, obviously, because of the depths and the inaccessibility of several of these structures, particularly the reward circuit, that is the ventral striatum to the ventral tegmental area, as well as the amygdala and the insula, it is quite difficult to actually access these structures, although some attempts have been made using deep RTMS to actually access the insula. So most of the studies in addiction, and for that matter, most of the studies in psychiatry have generally targeted the dorsolateral prefrontal cortex. And so even the study, in fact, that which I am doing on RTMS in alcohol dependence has used the dorsolateral prefrontal cortex as the target for stimulation. Now, the studies in addiction have been in various substances. The predominant ones have been nicotine, alcohol, and stimulants, that is cocaine and methamphetamines. I will just briefly talk about all of these substances. So as far as nicotine, there have been 10 studies that have been done. The sample sizes have been fairly small. Most of the studies are in the range of 10 to 20 sample size, but there is one large sham control trial with 115 subjects which has been done. The target in most of these cases has been the left dorsolateral prefrontal cortex. Most of them are single session, and there have been both high frequency and low frequency RTMS. What these studies have looked at as outcomes is basically craving or cue-induced craving. The maximum evidence for improvement in addiction has actually been in nicotine, where there have been significant decreases in cue-induced craving noticed with TMS. Of particular note would be this one study where Dinor and Klein have actually tried to target the insula, which is a deep structure in the medial temporal lobe. And they have done this using an H-shaped coil, and they've used compared both low and high frequency RTMS sessions over a period of 13 sessions. And this is something that has shown promising results, where there has actually been a reduction in cigarette consumption as measured by urinary cotinine levels. So they've actually had an objective marker of cigarette consumption as well, up to 3 months following 13 sessions of stimulation. As far as alcohol is concerned, there have been 7 studies which have been done, 2 of which have actually been done in India at CIP Ranchi. And again, the targets have predominantly been the right and left dorsolateral prefrontal cortex. And in a few studies, they've targeted the medial prefrontal cortex, which is again a slightly deeper structure, which utilizes the H-shaped coil. Again, the sessions have varied from single session up to 10 sessions. They've used high frequency stimulation uniformly, and the outcomes have been again mainly craving. So again, there is a variable response in terms of craving. Some studies have reported decreases in craving, some studies have reported no effect. But what is of interest is that almost none of these studies have actually looked on whether there is any change as far as lapse to alcohol or abstinence of alcohol or heavy drinking days. So actually our study, the study that we are doing here, the trial, in addition to actually looking at just craving, one of our outcome measures is also whether in the long term there is some decrease as far as time to lapse or total number of days of abstinence up to 3 months. So that is something that we need more information regarding, and there need to be more studies targeted towards that. Apart from that, as I had mentioned, there are 4 studies which have looked at cocaine and methamphetamine, again with fairly small sample sizes. The targets have again been the dorsolateral prefrontal and the medial prefrontal cortex. There has been a note of decreased craving for cocaine, but again, the studies are fairly preliminary and there needs to be more work that needs to be done in this field. So in summary, essentially what we can say is, as far as RTMS in addiction is concerned, there is certainly some potential, there is certainly some interesting prospects, but obviously one needs to take findings with a bit of a pinch of salt. It is a problem in RTMS studies across the world, even for RTMS studies for depression, the fact is that studies, the findings may not always be replicable in different settings. And one needs to keep doing studies in these fields to be able to actually have definitive evidence of the efficacy or the success of RTMS in treating various psychiatric disorders. So these are my references.